So our next organ system is the bone. And bones are made up of joints and tendons. Well, the system, I guess, is made up of joints, tendons, ligaments, and the bones themselves. So when we look at major functions of this organ system is support. It supports our body, gives our muscles something to attach to, keeps our organs in place. Protection, it protects those soft, delicate organs in the nervous system, like the brain and spinal cord are completely encased in bone. The heart and lungs are pretty well protected by the rib cage. The kidneys, not very well protected, right? They're kind of just floating out there, not cut encased by bone. And all the abdominal organs, not protected by bone. And that's why it's so important, you know, we wear our seatbelt. We also drive the speed limit and not do crazy driving, because those of you that work in the ER or in critical care, you know the damage to organs when people have high impact collisions. Spleens rupture, the highly vascular spleen will rupture and need to be removed. We can live without our spleen, but it puts us a little more at risk for viral infections. So it's not ideal to live without your spleen, but bones provide a good protection for a lot of those vital organs. Movement, we know that muscles attach to the bones, and when they contract, they pull our bones and allow our skeleton to move along. Storage, our bones store calcium, they store phosphate. Calcium phosphate is the bone, the component of bone that we have to bring in through our diet, the calcium and the phosphate, and our bone cells put those together and then solidify bone. Bone starts out as a flexible material, which we'll learn, and then it becomes a solid bone with the help of those osteoblasts converting that bone into hard calcium phosphate material. And we also have bone marrow. We have yellow marrow, which is a source of fat in our bones. So it's a storage area for fat as well. And in our flat bones and in the long bones of children, we also have that red bone marrow. So where our blood cells come from, when you're making more and more red blood cells as they die and you make new ones, that all occurs in the bone marrow, which is in the flat bones, in the adult bones, and then also in the long bones in that medullary cavity of kids. So red blood cells have a limited lifespan, and we need to make more. And there are certain things we know that help us make a good amount of red blood cells, and one of those is getting enough iron in our diet. And that sometimes is an issue with young college women. They don't have good iron stores. Sometimes it's just a genetic thing. Sometimes it's related to heavy menstrual periods. And heavy menstrual periods are not normal. So if you or someone you know struggles with heavy menstrual periods, they should be seen. That's often a sign of endometriosis, and that can be treated. So if that leads to a lot of blood loss and anemia, it's definitely something that needs to be looked at. So getting a good source of iron in our diet. And green leafy vegetables are a good source of iron. But they say that animal sources of iron are more readily absorbed and converted into stored iron than vegetable sources. So you have to eat a lot more green leafy vegetables, and those iron, like raisins are high in iron. There's a lot of other vegetable sources of iron, but you just have to eat a lot more of it to get the benefit from that. An easy thing to do is eat an iron fortified cereal. Raisin bran is a good one. It's got a really high amount of iron in it. Makes it less work to work on that iron, or take an iron supplement. So if you are someone who feels tired, kind of washed out all the time, pale, it might be a good idea to get your iron checked. And we do check that when we take it, if you take advanced AMP, that's one of the things we look at in lab. And it's interesting, I always have, out of 25 students I might have, I would say probably have 5 that have pretty low iron, and they know that they have low iron, or they're like, yeah, it doesn't surprise me. So something to pay attention to. So those are the major functions of bone. And another tissue that works with bone and we find in and around bone is hyaline cartilage. Hyaline cartilage is what makes up that articular cartilage that lines the outside of bones, so allows our joints to move against each other with less friction. And there's some shock absorbency and cushioning that occurs with that hyaline cartilage. So hyaline cartilage is the most abundant cartilage in the body, and it is found on the outside, articular cartilage. So it lines the bones at the joints. It's also found at the epiphyseal plate. So it's the epiphyseal plate, remember, is where our bones, we can tell if bones are done growing or not. We looked at that in lab, remember. It's a layer, it's a line of cartilage in the epiphyses of long bones. And that's where bone growth and length occurs. So that's hyaline cartilage there as well. And then most of the fetal skeleton before it ossifies later in development is made up of hyaline cartilage. So it's the most common cartilage we see working with bone. What the cells that we see here, you know, the fisheye soup we talked about in lab, these cells, instead of being called osteocytes because they make bone, they're called chondrocytes because they make cartilage. So chondro means cartilage. So chondroblasts make cartilage, chondrocytes maintain the cartilage. So you're going to learn a suffix today. Blasts means build. Don't think blasts as like blowing up and breaking apart. Some people confuse that. But blasts build. And another suffix we're going to learn are clasts. Clasts break down or cleave. Think of like a cleaver, cleaves, breaks into bits and pieces. We're going to talk more about that. So when we look at cartilage, it has an outer layer of cells called the perichondrium. Chondrium is because it's cartilage. Periosteum would be bone, the outer layer of bone. So we'll talk a little bit more about layers again of bone when it comes to bone growth and development. Elastic cartilage. This is a cartilage that we find in the ear and the epiglottis. It's a little more flexible. Fibrocartilage, we looked at a slide of that in lab. Remember, fibrocartilage still has those chondrocytes, the fisheye soup, but it has these thick, wavy collagen fibers. So those collagen fibers can make it look like dense, regular collagenous, but dense, regular collagenous has those really thin cells called fibroblasts, so it looks a little different. If you see the rounded, you know, chondrocytes here, you know you're looking at fibrocartilage. So these thick collagen fibers provide a lot of cushion and support, you know, to bear the pressure of our bones rubbing against one another. So the meniscus of the knee, so the femur and the tibia come together into these C-shaped, kind of cup-shaped menisci, and that supports the knee. So if people tear a meniscus, you know, they'll feel that when they turn and move their knee joint, because those are really important supportive structures where the femur and the tibia come together. So those thick collagen fibers are essential for that strength. And we also find them in the intervertebral discs between the vertebrae. So when you look at bone tissue under a microscope, the matrix, so that's the stuff that the osteoblasts make and the osteocytes maintain, that's just the soup, right? The white stuff that we see. 35% of that is inorganic, so it's made up of, 35% is organic. That's the living stuff. That's stuff that cells can make. So collagen is a protein that bone cells make. And remember, what does collagen do for bone that we learned in lab? Keeps it flexible. Yeah, so if I soak a bone in acid, it'll pull all the calcium phosphate out, and I'll have a very flexible bone that is more collagen than calcium. So proteoglycans, collagen, provide flexibility and resiliency of that bone. And again, that's what the bone cells make. So that's why it's organic. Only living cells are going to contain that collagen in proteoglycans. The inorganic is hydroxyapatite, and what that is a fancy name for the calcium phosphate salts that make bone hard, okay? So that's the inorganic part. So most of our bone is this inorganic hydroxyapatite, otherwise known as calcium phosphate, and little other pieces added to it we're not going to go into, but that's what makes our bone hard. And most of it is that inorganic component. So if we want calcium in our, we know that our bones break down. Bone is a living tissue, just like our skin. We replace our bone every 10 years, and then that slows down when we get to be about 35 years old. So if we want to have good bone growth and repair, we need to make sure we have a good amount of calcium in our diet, because we don't make, bone cells don't make calcium. Calcium has to come from the outside. Collagen and proteoglycans, our cells do make that. They take the bits and pieces, the amino acids in our diet, they break them down and reassemble them to make collagen. So that is produced by our body. So it's important that we get good calcium throughout our lives. So there's three types of bone cells: osteoblasts build bone, so those are cells that actually make new bone. Osteocytes maintain bone, so once it's been built and it's in place and stable, the osteocytes maintain it. And then osteoclasts break down bone, cleave bone. So it's just like when you're remodeling a house, you have to rip out the old kitchen and put in the new kitchen, right? And then you move in and you maintain that kitchen by keeping it clean and doing whatever you need to do. So the osteoblasts are what builds the new bone, and the osteoclasts are what tear it down. So we have stem cells also. They're called osteochondral progenitor cells. I'm not going to hold you accountable for that, but just so you know, there is another group of cells related to bone that are stem cells. So there's three types of bone. Woven bone is the early bone that is formed when you break a bone, and that is converted to compact bone or cancellous bone, depending on where that woven bone is being formed. And then cancellous bone, we know we find in what part of bone? What in the long bone? Where do we find cancellous? Another name for cancellous is spongy bone. So maybe you want to add that word next to that, spongy bone. And where do we find spongy bone? Do you remember? Yeah, the ends of our long bones, the epiphyses, yep. And then that compact bone is in the margins of the long bone, right? And on the edges of our bones, where we see solid bone with no air spaces, that's compact bone. So we talked about bone anatomy in lab. I'm not going to go through that again. It's just that you should, but I do expect that you remember that and can carry that information forward. So you can review that slide on your own. Just remember that red marrow in children contains red blood cells and all those white blood cells. So that's important for immune system development. If a person needs a bone marrow transplant, for example, if they have leukemia, leukemia means white blood. It means the white blood cells are growing out of control. So that means they're going to have a lot of extra white blood cells that are damaged and non-functional, because cancer is mitosis gone wild. So when the white blood cells in the bone marrow start to increase in number and they're abnormally functioning, they don't protect the immune system, so kids are sick all the time. They have a fever because the immune response is always activated from those abnormal white blood cells. And they're going to have bone pain because they have excess white blood cell production in that bone marrow, in the long bones. So oftentimes that can be treated by a bone marrow transplant, where they totally destroy all the living cells and they replace it with healthy bone marrow from a donor. And if that donor is an adult, a good source to get that bone marrow is in the flat bone of the ilium, which is in the hip. So they'll go in and retrieve the bone marrow there. And many people have been treated successfully with a bone marrow transplant. So we talked about the matrix. Without enough calcium phosphate, our bones are too flexible. Without collagen, they're too brittle. So we need a little bit of flexibility and hardness, that right balance. So we said osteoblasts build bone. So if we look at what an osteoblast looks like, it's here. It's this pretty large cell because it's pretty active. It's making collagen and those proteoglycans and making new bone, so it's a pretty large cell. An osteocyte is when bone has already been built and it's just going to maintain, and the size of the cell shrinks, but it has these extensions because when they're stuck in that hard bone, they need to be able to receive and give off waste, receive nutrients, give off waste within the matrix. So they have these canaliculi. Remember we looked at those in the cell models? So that's what the osteocytes have that are a little different. And then the osteoclasts have these nice little cellular extensions that help to break down bone. They're kind of like a little sweeper that comes across and cleaves bones and digests the bone to release the calcium to the blood. Because calcium is great for keeping our bones hard, but we're going to find this semester that calcium is vitally important for muscle contraction and nerve conduction. So without muscle contraction, what major muscle do we rely on to stay alive on a second-to-second basis? What muscle? Your heart. Yeah. So if your heart's not getting the calcium it needs to beat, the body's going to say, get us some calcium in this blood ASAP. So what cells are going to be activated to go get some calcium and break down bone. Osteoclast. Yep, osteoclast. So there's hormones that are secreted that we're going to learn about that are stimulate osteoclast to break down bone if calcium levels are too low in the blood. So again, that's why it's important that we get enough in our diet, because your body is constantly using calcium to supply muscle contraction, and if there's not enough, it's just going to go after your bones to get it. So as a young person, and when you're if you end up having a baby and developing a baby, that skeleton in that baby is going to also need calcium, and if there's not enough in the blood, it'll go after the mom's bones to get it. So it's really important that we take care of our bone density as younger people. I shouldn't say we, because I'm over the hill now, but for you guys that are young, value that bone density and keep building it, because once you get, you know, 65 and older, to try to build bone density is very difficult. There's only one thing you can do, and that is to get weight-bearing exercise. But sometimes that's not enough, and people need these powerful calcium replacement treatments that have side effects and are not ideal. So it's just best to, and your kids too, think of those of you that have kids or relatives, nieces, nephews, whatever, siblings, you know, what are they eating that has calcium? If they're not a milk drinker, or do they like cheese? Are there other options for calcium? Because we have to think about that. And diet sodas, especially diet Pepsis, diet Cokes, they have sodium phosphate, I believe. And when you digest sodium phosphate, the sodium separates from the phosphate. What does that phosphate look for? What did we say the major salt is in bone? Calcium. It's going to pull calcium from your bone to bond to that phosphate. And then as a result, there's less calcium in your bone. So drinking diet sodas that contain sodium phosphate are not good for bone health. Okay, so osteocytes, we said, are mature bone cells. They're stuck in these lacuna because the bone has hardened, so there's just a space where those osteocytes sit in living bone. And then those extensions, the canaliculi, off of the osteocytes form little canals in the bone, little indentations in the bone, and we see after it's hardened. And again, osteoclasts are responsible for bone resorption. The term resorption means to resorb or to break it down. So if you don't know the word resorption, then just cross it out and write breaks it down. So we want just the right balance of osteoclast activity with osteoblast activity. So here we see the surface of bone here. These are osteoblasts building new bone. So this is trabeculae and spongy bone. We can see this is red bone marrow here, the little dots, right, and the white. This will be on probably the lab quiz, identifying that. And then we have the osteocytes that are stuck in these lacuna. So these dark dots here are osteocytes and lacuna of living bone, potentially, or it could be dead bone if it was a slide prepared from a cadaver, which most often is. So we find osteoblasts on the outer surface where growth occurs. Woven bone, like I said, is a weak form of bone. It's formed, it's the early bone formed during fetal development, when we're repairing a fracture, or when we're remodeling, removing old bone, adding new bone. That early bone is called woven bone. And that will be converted to regular bone, either spongy or compact bone. So again, this remodeling occurs every 10 years in a younger adult. And as we get older, there's less remodeling occurring. So we learned in lab about these trabeculae. That's like the bony scaffolding of spongy bone. What's pretty interesting is this trabeculae lines itself up over regions of stress and gravity. So the person in the video, the karate guy that was splitting the brick with his forehead, you can't do that the first day. You'll crack your forehead, right? So what they do is they start with weaker boards, and as they try to crack the, or even if they're using their hand or their foot, those trabeculae receive that stress with the weaker board, and they build more trabeculae in alignment of that. So that's where we talk about weight-bearing exercise. When you apply weight or stress to a bone, that causes those trabeculae to thicken. It stimulates osteoblasts to make more bone along that scaffolding. And it goes, again, along the line of stress. Here's the femur, so there's more trabeculae along the line of stress where the femur is. So a person, as they go in karate or taekwondo or whatever, and they continue on further and further, they can progress to being able to break a concrete brick, right? Because they've worked up the trabeculae through repeated stress to make that bone very hard. So what happens if you send a bunch of astronauts and they're floating around in space for 6 months? What do you think happens to their trabeculae? What? Yeah, it breaks down. Without weight-bearing stress on those trabeculae, those bones break down. And we did find that before we knew about this, that we needed to exercise those astronauts. Well, how do they get weight-bearing activity in a zero-gravity environment? What do you do? What? Yeah, you'd have to strap them down to a surface and have them do resistance exercises, right? So like weightlifting, you can't do weightlifting, but you can use bands, right? And special machines that work in a stretchy way, not a gravity way, right? So these trabeculae are really important. And if you don't walk correctly, like let's say someone's got a bad hip and they start walking like this down the hall, like some of our older nurses, what happens to the trabeculae then? They realign to the way you're walking. So then when you get that corrected, sometimes those trabeculae are not lined up properly for stress because people have been walking incorrectly for so long that it's really important that they do physical therapy to get things, you know, lined up again correctly. So it's pretty cool how the body responds to the stresses we place on it. And if we don't place any stress, then it doesn't build those trabeculae, just like our muscles. If we don't use our muscles become thin and weak over time. So we have to get our patients up and moving, get them out of bed, even though they don't want to. We have to tell them why. If you lay in bed, you're going to get weaker and weaker, and you're not going to get out of here. You know, because some of the older patients, you know, they want to go home to their homes. And you have to tell them, yeah, I know you just had surgery 2 days ago, and I'll get you some pain medicine to help with the pain, but we got to get you up and moving, even if it's just to the door and back. We got to get those muscles activated, or you're never going to get out of bed. And just telling them the reason why makes a big difference in motivating people. So compact bone, like we said, is a little different than spongy bone. It's solid bone. It's made up of these circular units called osteons. And the osteocytes line each layer within an osteon. And what do we call the layers within the osteon? It has three L's in it. Make sure you know these terms for the lab quiz. Lamella. Yeah, lamella is a layer of bone matrix, collagen and calcium phosphate, that's been laid down by osteoblasts. And then those osteoblasts become osteocytes as that bone hardens. So remember that each osteon has a nice blood supply and a nerve supply, so bones are painful and they have a good blood supply. So they do heal quickly, that's the good thing. But they can heal incorrectly if we don't get them checked out. So when we look at how bones develop from a fetal, during fetal development, there's two types. There's intramembranous and there's endochondral. Now I've put it in red and underlined it. So probably on the quiz in some shape or form, right? So intramembranous, what helps us is starts with a connective tissue membrane. So membranous gives us a hint of what the starting material is. And endochondral, endo means inside. Chondra, what do we say that means? Cartilage. So endochondral means inside cartilage. So hyaline cartilage, remember we said that was in the fetal skeleton before it ossifies? This is most of our skeleton was formed by endochondral ossification. So both methods, whether it starts with a membrane or hyaline cartilage, it forms woven bone, which is that weak bone. And then after it's remodeled, whether it becomes spongy bone or compact bone, doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what the starting material looked like, whether it was a membrane or hyaline cartilage. We have bone at the end. We have ossification. So there's two types. Like I said, intramembranous. Remember the fontanelles we looked at in lab last week, in the front and back and front sides, back sides of the fetal skull. Those are the membranes where intramembranous ossification, that's what's left at the end of intramembranous ossification. When that baby's born, there's a little bit of those membranes, those connective tissue membranes left. And those will continue to ossify until they harden, and all we have left is what? That jagged line. What do we call those? The jagged lines between our cranial bones? Sutures, right. So once the sutures form, that connective membrane, that intramembranous ossification is complete. And we said about age 2 is when that process is complete. And again, endochondral is basically a hyaline cartilage model of our long bones and rib cage and spine that eventually ossifies to become bone. Again, compact bone or spongy bone. So whether it's intramembranous or endochondral doesn't matter at the end of the game because you have bone. But you need to know the different starting points. So if I look at intramembranous, here's a fetal skull. So I have this connective tissue membrane, and ossification is beginning in the center of that connective tissue membrane, and it's working its way to the edges. So that makes sense then why the edges would not be complete, right, when we look at those fontanelles in the baby. And there's also a portion of the clavicle that undergoes intramembranous ossification. But again, osteoblasts are found at the center of ossification, right, because their job is to build bone. So in the center here, we'll find osteoblasts, and they're making bone, working its way from the center out. So endochondral ossification, like I said, starts out with a cartilage model. Cartilage is usually shown as blue in our textbook. So we can see this cartilage model here. There's a primary ossification center forming in the middle of the bone. And that's going to have both osteoblasts and osteoclasts, because we need a medullary cavity in here, don't we? So we need to build bone, but we also need to create a cavity. And the way to create a cavity is with osteoclast activity. So as that comes in, we get more and more of a medullary cavity. And then later on in fetal development, we have secondary ossification centers forming in the epiphyses. And that's where we see the continuation of growth. And this is going to happen, you know, into childhood. So you can see this little remainder of cartilage here, that's the epiphyseal plate. And that's going to continue that length, the growth and length of those bones. So chondroblasts are in that cartilage model. And then the primary ossification center begins in the center of the bone. Blood vessels grow in and bring more cells. Osteoclasts break it down to make that medullary cavity. And then shortly before birth, those secondary ossification centers form for the growth and length. We wouldn't want a lot of growth and length prior to birth, right? Make it more difficult for childbirth. So here is kind of a side view of an actual skeleton. And the darker areas are areas of active cell or of cell activity. So we can see the darker regions are where the primary ossification centers are. So you can see at the ends of the long bones, we have the epiphyses where there's ossification occurring. But I shouldn't say primary ossification, because if I look at this, I see darker areas on the ends. So that would be a secondary ossification center. So you can cross this out and just say ossification centers. Whether it's primary or secondary doesn't matter, but it's areas of active cell, of cell activity, I mean. So the darker areas are where we would see that. So achondroplasia is another name for dwarfism. And the dwarfism gene is one of those that if a person has dwarfism and has the living version that you can survive with, like these children here on the couch, they are what we call heterozygous. They have one normal copy for cartilage growth and one abnormal copy. So that one parent gave a good copy, the other parent gave a bad copy. So This is often caused by mutation, but if you have two parents, like in this show, Big Little People, Big World, right? Do you remember this at all? These parents both have dwarfism, but they had the living kind that they're able to survive. This baby is what's called double dwarf. They inherited both copies of the dwarfism gene, and babies don't survive with this. And what do you see is the main problem with this baby that would make it difficult to survive or impossible to survive? Yes, look at the size of that chest cavity. How can those lungs expand and allow that baby to breathe? So that baby can't survive. But if they have one good copy, they have enough bone growth to survive, but the long bone growth is affected. So what happens is achondroplasia, A means without, chondro means cartilage, right? So those secondary ossification center in the epiphyses and the growth plate, the epiphyseal plate, do not lengthen for people with achondroplasia. So they have very short, thick bones. So bones grow in thickness, but they don't grow in length. So as a result, we see, you know, the skull is typically okay, because those are not hyaline cartilage, but the rest of the body, the long bones, are affected. So when you look at these, so the chance of giving a bad copy from mom and dad, and both of those coming together to form this, is 25%. The chance of mom and dad giving a good copy of their pair of genes for this disorder is 25%. And the chance of them, of one parent giving a good and one parent giving a bad, is 50%. And you'll learn the genetics of that in advanced A&P if you need to take that. So if we look at what happened here, they had four children, only one of them. So they had a 50% chance of having a child with dwarfism, the living kind. Only one of their children got it. They had a 25% chance of having healthy children, and all three of them out of the four were healthy. So when we look at genetics and we look at probabilities in healthcare, it's really important to remember, when you look at big numbers, we see trends. So if I took, you know, 10,000 couples and looked at their kids, we would see that it would follow these trends, right? But when we look at individual families, they can definitely defy those odds. And it's important that we remember that ourselves when we're counseling patients, or someone tells us, well, your chance of having this disease or of having a child with a problem is this percent. We don't always get that in small numbers. So just like families, right? What is the chance of having a boy or a girl? 50%. Do you see families with all girls? Six of them? Yeah. See families with all boys? Yeah. So we do defy those odds in small numbers. But this is damage to the growth plate, abnormal function of the growth plate that causes dwarfism. Well, the only part that undergoes intramembranous is the skull and part of the clavicle. So they have abnormal growth in the axial skeleton as well. Yeah, but less, more of it is in the long bones, because that's where we see more active secondary ossification centers. All right, so bones grow in length. When we look at how this works, if this is the epiphyseal plate, we see hyaline cartilage here. So we have new hyaline cartilage on the top of the plate. So this is toward the end of the bone here. And we see new bone forming below the plate. So you have this layer of hyaline cartilage. The bottom part of the plate is turning to bone, and the top is making new cartilage, because we don't want to just convert the whole cartilage plate to bone at age 2 and that's it. We're that size now, right? So throughout life, we're always maintaining the size of that epiphyseal plate until puberty is complete and we're done growing. We're always making new cartilage on the top of the plate and new bone on the bottom of the plate. So as we're making new bone on the bottom, that is growing in length, okay? So that's the process of growth in length. So when we look at how that works, we call that interstitial growth. When it's growth between cells, We call that interstitial growth. So it's growing in length interstitially. These cells are embedded among other cells. When we're plopping bone on the outside, when bones are growing in thickness, we call that appositional growth because we're adding it to the outside. So again, here's our epiphyseal plate. We have new cartilage on top of the plate, new bone below the plate by interstitial growth. But then if we're making bones thicker, like I said, we're working on the outside or inside, we call that appositional growth. So if I'm going to grow this femur bone, this is a cross-section of a femur bone here, let's say, the green layer is going to have what type of cells if I want to grow it in thickness? Clasts, blasts, or sites? What? Blasts. Osteoblasts are going to build that bone in thickness. But if I make it thicker, do I want to keep that tiny medullary cavity on the inside, on the red layer? No. So we have to do what? We have to carve out the medullary cavity. So the red layer has what types of cells? Clasts, osteoclasts. So we have thickness going to the outside, but we're also making that medullary cavity larger as well. So there's a difference there. But that's appositional growth because we're adding it on the outside surface of bone. So we'll pick up at the next video looking at the rest of the notes on bone.